quantum. But this is a fact that quantum mechanical predictions and experiments, insofar as they have been done, do not agree with that. That's just a brutal fact of nature. The genetic hypothesis, which seems absolutely compelling for parallel devices, simply doesn't work for non-parallel devices. You can't get away with the genetic hypothesis. And therefore, the Einsteinian argument failed. No action at a distance, leading to determinism in the case of parallel polarizers, but determinism in the case of all parallel polarizers leads you back to action at a distance. Now, in my opinion, in answer to the question that you posed at the beginning, I don't know. This phrase is too strong and active an assertion. I cannot say that action at a distance is required in physics. But I can say that you cannot get away with no action at a distance. You cannot separate off what happens in one place and what happens in another. Somehow, they have to be described and explained jointly. Well, that's just the fact of the situation. The Einstein program failed. That's too bad for Einstein, but should we worry about that? Super. Now, there are three replies to the question, so what? One is that the whole idea of action at your distance is very repugnant to physics. If I were speaking for an hour rather than half an hour, I would bombard you with quotations from Newton, and Einstein, and Bohr, and all the other great men, telling you how unthinkable it is that by doing something here, we can change the situation in a remote way. I think that the founding fathers of quantum did not so much meet Einstein's arguments about the desirability of no action at distance. They looked away. The whole idea that either it might be determinism or actuality was so repugnant to them that they looked away. Well, that's tradition. And we have to learn in life sometimes to learn new traditions. And it might be that we have to learn to accept not so much action at a distance, the inadequacy of no action at a distance. There are two more professional reasons for the identity situation. Now, one is relativity. According to relativity, the notion of simultaneity is relative. And events which are simultaneous for one observer are not simultaneous for another. So it does not make sense for very distant situations to say that one event has occurred before or after another. So if we allow the result at one of these experimental setups to depend on what an experimenter does at the other, then what a puzzle, because we would not like what he does here to have an effect there before it is done here. But if I say that this is affecting that, I can find some observer for whom this comes after that. So if I set up a traditional causal model in which the cause effects are allowed to be non-local in the sense of propagating instantaneously over large distances, in some frame of reference, the cause will come before the effect. So I have to be more subtle than that somehow. I have to find some way of devising a situation which allows something somehow to go from one place to another very quickly, but without conflict with special relativity. And that has not been done. We have the statistical predictions of quantum mechanics, and they seem to be right. The correlations seem to cry out for an explanation, and we don't have one. The other reason is no signals. It is a fact that I cannot use whatever this non-local connection is to send signals. When you look at what quantum mechanics predicts, it predicts, so long as you look at just one side or other of this experiment, you will simply have no information about what is happening in the other place. No matter what that other fellow does with his equipment, you will not notice anything funny happening in your side. As an analogy of that, I could say, supposing we were tossing coins, I here, and one of you people down here, and supposing I had the power to say that your coin will turn an extra time before it falls on the table. Now you're looking at your coins and you see heads, tails, heads, tails. And you don't know when I have exercised my power to turn it once more, because you didn't know whether it was going to fall heads or tails. So we have a curious situation that to explain the correlations between my results and yours, you have to invoke some such mysterious power, but it is one which I absolutely cannot use to send you a message. I got here a demonstration of that. This is a computer simulation of such an experiment in which people are calling heads and tails. When it comes up heads, I have written H, and for tails I have written a blank so that you can see it from where it's fitting. And it's a random energy field. At some point I exercise my power, my remote power, to turn it into a tail. And here's the result. There, I have done something to the random code in the exchange heads for tails, but you absolutely cannot see that. This message, as far as you're concerned, is as meaningless as the next. And it's only if you have two copies of that that you can compare, that you can see that something funny. That curious situation has inspired musical composition. There's a musical composition called the Bell's Theorem Blues. And I'm not going to sing it, but I'll say the words. Dr. Bell say we connected, he called me on the phone, but if we really together, baby, how come I feel so all alone? And that is the dilemma. We are led by analyzing this situation to see that somehow distant things are connected, or at least not disconnected. And yet, we do not feel that we are connected up to the customer. So any resolution of this situation, I think, you cannot just say, oh, nature is like that. I think you must find a picture in which the perfect correlations are natural without implying determinism, because that leads you back to nonlocality. And also in which this independence, as far as our individual experiences goes, our independence of the rest of the world, is also natural. So the connections have to be very subtle. And I have told you all that I know about them. Thank you.
Thank you.